Thank you for inviting me to giving this talk here, and thank you for staying here even there, although the coffee break's officially running now. I hope you have time some to get some information from my research. I can now link to my previous speakers also, because I have also wood here, and this has been degraded, as we heard, from fungi and bacteria, and in this case, we have also some preservatives which are used to protect such wood. So wood is a nice building compound and has been used for wooden constructions inside of houses and outside of houses. And if it's in contact with soil, we have this microbiome we already heard, where many microorganisms are present, and these are able to degrade wood even though preservatives are present. And I have done some research at the Federal Institute of Material Research and Testing and with some companies. I will name them later on. And they are interested to get better preservatives, to get those wood longer in the constructions, to enlarge the service life of such wood. And therefore, we have one compound here, which is Kappa HDO, which has been introduced into preservative world in 1980s and still is being used as also fulfill all the requirements of the actual governmental situation. So maybe it's already been said, wood degradation in terrestrial ecosystems is a very important process. So all wood has been brought up in nature has also to be degraded. And if it's done under aerobic conditions, it's mainly done by white and brown rot fungi. But we already heard that bacteria are also quite intriguing and necessary for wood degradation. And especially if these anaerobic conditions are present, bacteria take over and they degrade wood. Also, if you have aerobic terrestrial ecosystems, this wood decaying fungi do not do this job alone. They are accompanying by bacteria. And there's some lack of knowledge which bacteria are present and which functions these bacteria have. And so those make synergistic processes from bacteria and fungi, both to try to degrade preserved and non-preserved wood. Non-preserved wood is much easier. This goes quite fast. So if you have aerobic conditions, the wood's been degraded in a half year or in up to 2 or 3 years. If you have preserved wood, they can enlarge the time of degradation up to 20 to 30 years. And this is the main issue here in my work, that we want to know how, even after 30 years, degradation can be done. So coming to the first part, also I have two parts, sorry. First part is dealing with Kappa HDO and how it's been degraded in soil environments. And thereafter, I have a new wood protection system, which I will introduce, and I will also give some results to that also. So let me come to the first part. So we have Kappa HDO as a preservative, which is, if you have a preservative, we have many different parts. You have Kappa, you have Kappa sulfate, and you have the Kappa HDO in some formulation stuff, which helps to penetrate your wood and to get the Kappa HDO as deep as possible inside the wood. But here I only worked with Kappa HDO, and we just looked how this Kappa HDO can be degraded by the soil microbial community and which organisms do this job. For doing so, we have had some wood and we have milled the wood to sawdust, and this gives us an homogeneous part of wood, which can be easily added with different amounts of this Kappa HDO. And as you see this Kappa HDO, we have this N-cyclo-diazemium oxygenic part here, and we have the Kappa part here, which is two times here. And for doing this research, which I'm explaining later on, we have exchanged the carbons here from 12C carbons to 13C carbons, meaning that 12C is original carbon, which you can have in environmental situation quite frequently, And if you use 13C, it's isotopically enriched. So you have one neutron more in the atom. So it's a little bit heavier, this 13C labeled carbon HDO. So we have added this to the sawdust independently, and we came up to this experimental setup. So we have 12C carbon HDO, 13C carbon HDO, and we have no addition of carbon HDO. And then we used the same soil, and we added it and five replicates the soil to this carbon HDO sawdust mixture. And we also did this without carbon HDO, with sterilized soil, just to check if it's a chemical breakdown of carbon HDO or if it's a microbial breakdown of these compounds. And so also we did this without of soil, just to see if there is a timely breakage of carbon HDO just without any reason of soil. And then we did some measurements. This is maybe of interest for you, because we used different methods to get a whole picture of this. We monitored the carbon dioxide formation just to see if there is a respiration activity present in soil. We measured the carbon HDO concentration over time, and we extracted some biomarkers. The first one was phospholipid fatty acids, and the second one was RNA, which can be is composed by carbon. And once this 13C carbon from the HDO has been released, it may also be introduced by catabolic interactions into the biomarkers. And we monitored the delta 13C of CO2 in soil and in carbon HDO, and also we checked some metabolite identification from this carbon HDO. Just to introduce the techniques, so we have some closed bottle systems, and we measure the delta 13C in the soil. We measured the carbon HDO quantity in the soil, and also we tested to verify different metabolites, which raise up over time. And also we used this setup to extract these biomarkers. We used infrared gas analyzer just to see how much carbon dioxide has been formed. And we used the same setup later on to precipitate this carbon dioxide in barium hydroxide to check how the delta 13C in carbon dioxide is, just to monitor how active the community is and how it's been the carbon 13C label has been inside the system. Just a smart introduction in stable isotope probing. Maybe some of you doesn't know how this technique works. This is based on a publication from Friedrich et al. So you have 13C labeled substrates, which been introduced in a microcosm. Then you have a microbiome of different microorganisms, and some are capable to degrade the substrates, and some, mainly the same, maybe some others, are able to assimilate those 13C substrates into their biomass, including or incorporating this 13C label into their biomarkers, like RNA or phospholipid fatty acids. If we use RNA, we make then an isotopic separation by ultracentrifugation. This is a high-speed centrifugation where you then have a separation of labeled 13C labeled RNA and 12C RNA. And after centrifugation, you can just drop out the different fractions, and then you can do different molecular fingerprinting techniques and so on. The other way you can do is you can just use the phospholipid fatty acids, and then you can directly, after small extraction protocol, use GC combustion RMS to see which phospholipid fatty acids are present and which delta 13C are incorporated in the respective PFAs. So therefore you get a direct link of function, who is able to incorporate the stuff in the genetic identity, and you also can verify that this copper HDO is bioavailable inside the system. So coming now to the results of the first part, what you can see here, that we use quite low amounts of copper HDO, which are the usual amounts which can be released from soil, from wood into soil in about half year. This was our assumption, that is, this can be released and gives some death zone between soil and wood and may force those microbes to degrade these compounds. And as you can see, it's almost stable a long time. After 64 days and 105 days, it's been decreasing. And the same is for 12C and the 13C copper HDO treatments we used. We also did not only looked for 13C amounts, but also for the metabolites by using GCMS, and we see that this first breakage is this part where we have cyclohexanone and this N-diiacene compounds. This is a bottleneck. If once this bondage is being broken, this cyclohexanone can be rapidly degraded. So therefore, we see that if this breakage has been done, the other compounds are rapidly removed. And you can see this easily if you compare the 12C copper HDO with the 13C copper HDO, because they have different peaks where the carbon has been some isotopic because it's mass to size separation here, which are a little bit more mass, you can see. Coming to the CO2 formation, so if you have no addition of copper HDO, see that there's a high accumulative carbon dioxide release, so there is soil respiration running. However, if there is copper HDO introduced, this soil respiration has been reduced. And this is quite significantly already in the first days, but in the late time period, it's increasing. Then coming to the delta 13C of CO2, so we have seen that the formation of carbon dioxide is being reduced. However, if you compare then the 12C and the 13C carbon dioxide, then you see that this has been increasing after 32 days, 64 days, 105 days, in the meaning that there's been a total breakage of this copper HDO leading to the formation of carbon dioxide. So it's been degraded, and the arena is now open, and wood can be degraded by the usual microbiome. Then we used different time points here for this stable isotope probing for this fatty acids and also for the RNA. And by doing so, we get a fingerprint of the for lipid fatty acids, and you can see that the initial indicious community is somehow different to those after certain days. And if you look at that, you see some phospholipid fatty acids are increasing in their relative abundance and some are decreasing. Moreover, by doing this GCC-RMS technique, we can also see which of these shown phospholipid fatty acids have also an incorporation of delta 13C, meaning it's not only been increasing in the relative abundance, but also degrading and uptaking the 13C into their biomass. And interestingly, it's the same three which are increasing have the highest amounts of delta 13C inside their fatty acids. However, the resolution of this phospholipid fatty acids is not so nice. We can see this is bacteria, this are gram-negative bacteria, it's also gram-negative bacteria, but you don't go too much into detail in the phylogenetic information you receive. And these are the ones which are decreasing. They have also some incorporation of delta 13C. This is maybe caused by cross-feeding. We already have heard it very briefly in the last talk or in the previous talk, because this means that the carbon sources being degraded, and not all which can degrade the stuff are taking up the carbon sources. So there's a food web, and some others are also able to use utilize such carbon. By estimating the amounts of labeling, we also try to do a RNA zip, and we have been successful. This was quite nice. And then you have a light fraction and a heavy fraction. And you have the density gradients. This is a light fraction here, and this is a heavy fraction. And this is also a fingerprinting technique. And this fingerprinting technique can be combined by cloning and sequencing. That's what we have done. And by doing so, we have some tier, also some operative taxonomic units here, which are indicative for the degradation. And by cloning and sequencing, we found that these are affiliated to members of Acidobacterium and Phenylobacterium. This Phenylobacterium is known to make the first step in the degradation by xenobiotics by this six ring to the N compounds. So that this can break down this part and then may also utilize this as carbon source. However, Acidobacteria has been not so frequently cultured, and we do not have any detailed information how the enzymatic degradation process of kappa HTU may run in these organisms. So let me just conclude from the first part of this talk. There is a degradation of kappa HTO as wood preservative, which is delayed, so it's quite low amounts introduced. However, even though low amounts, it's been very, very slowly being degraded. The activity of the overall macro community is being reduced based on this carbon dioxide formation. And by doing RNA-zip, we could explain that this Phenylobacterium and Acidobacteria are the most labeled biomarkers found in this environment. By the GC-MS, we found also other metabolites. However, we should cross-check this with pure cultures of these compounds, and these are hard to get, and therefore we don't want to make too harsh assumptions. Therefore, we just know cyclohexane is one of the compounds, and the others, which are very low in the amount, we could not really affiliate to. Okay, coming now to my second part of the talk. So if you go to vineyard or to apple plantations, these wood preservative companies, they guaranteed their customers, if you buy our wood preservatives, it will have standing times for 10 to 15 years. However, nature tells you another story. It's about 1 to 2 years, and thereafter, wood degradation has been taking place. And if there's some wind in the vineyards, and these wooden constructions break down, and then there is some regression. So the companies which build up the stuff come to the wood company and says, please give us the money back. And therefore, they asked some microbiologists how we can solve this problem. And especially these environments are quite intriguing, because these vineyards and apple plantations in Europe, for instance, I don't know how it's in other countries, have been introduced to different fungicides. And these are based on kappa treatments. And therefore, there's an enrichment of kappa in the upper part of the soil in both. And these are parts in Europe where this has been applied since several years. I think it's since 30 or 40 years. These kappa treatments of fungicides have been introduced. So what we have in Europe is this REACH, where you have to you're not allowed to get new chemicals on the market for biocides as preservatives. You can only use those which are restricted, allowed to, and therefore you do different combinations. And one kind of preservative which is used here is quats, so quaternary ammonium composition combined with copper, which has a good knowledge that they will work to protect the wood inside. And what we did as new innovative way to save our preservatives from bacterial degradation, we used this layer-by-layer technique to encapsulate the biocide inside. This is polyanionic coverages. So we have anionic, cationic, polyanionic, and anionic ones circled around. And then there's a shell around, and this gives some good properties. One of the properties is that you can change the electric charge, which may enables to penetrate the wood even better. And that's the case. You cannot penetrate only 3 to 4 centimeters. Now you can penetrate 10 to 15 centimeters inside the wood. So this is a good job. The next one is that you can do this encapsulation that the microbes cannot interact here. So it's been covered. This is also quite nice. Then microbes like bacteria are not able, even though if they are coming inside the wood fibers, not to degrade these biocides. And finally, as you have different polyanionic coverages here, you can make a release by pH. So as we already heard, there are extracellular enzymes by white and brown rod fungi, and they excrete their enzymes, and then like lactase and peroxidases, they decrease the pH inside the wood. So usual pH you have is pH 5, and then the pH has been reduced to pH 2. And this, like the Fenton reaction, I can tell you a lot, but keep me short. This will enable here that this encapsulation will be opened and the biocide been released, and then it can also be attack directly the fungi which are working. And these quats and copper are known to be very active against fungi. So this is quite intriguing kind of encapsulation. The particle size is quite small, so you can really penetrate deeply, and there's a setup potential, which means it's a high binding efficiency towards the wood fibers. So, as a microbiologist, I was more interested how this works in the microbiome, the soil microbiome, and we made a laboratory-based study here, and we used 5 soils from different vineyard and fruit-growing environments, and we have had 5 different treatments, which is water, just as a control. We preserved the wood with water. We preserved wood with copper, triazole, benzalkylium chloride, and then with encapsulation, with non-encapsulation, and also copper alone, just to see. However, we did this laboratory study because usually it takes 5 to 10 years that there's a major degradation process running. Therefore, we used this in a laboratory study where we have evaluated climatic conditions, and we used here concentrations which are only the tenth of the concentrations used in the field site. So just to get the time shortened to see something in this schedule. So we can see where we have moved down. So we have also made some trips here. We have been in northern Germany, in central Germany. So here we are located here. We have also been in France. Nice trip, North France, South France, and Portugal. These are field sites where you already know that there is a micro community present which can rapidly degrade those wood constructions. And then we make some soil characteristics just to know if there's anything similar in between, but we can say in detail some things are similar, but the majority are not. So I think based on this, the environmental conditions are so different, the microbiome may also be different between those places. So what we did now, we did this laboratory-based study. We have preserved 440 wood specimen, and we used 5 soil sampling sites, 5 treatments, 4 incubation time points, 8, 16, 24, and 32 weeks, and we used 4 replicates because there's some variance in between, just to check if this gives us good information. And we also make some virulence controls, just adding some wood specimens which are not being treated. Then we incubated this by 28 degrees, 64% air humidity, and then we sampled the interface between the wood and the soil, make DNA extraction. We take the soil slowly without wood contact, and we take the wood also. And from the soil samples, we make DNA extraction, then we make amplicon sequencing, which means that we get a huge amount of sequences from 2 genes. One is the ITS gene, responsible for fungi, and the 16S RNA gene, which recovers the bacterial diversity. Oh, in time? Okay, I will hurry up. And then also we make some quantitative PCR. Finally, we make also some material testing from the wood, like the mass loss and the bending elasticity, and we did for all statistical analysis. So what you can see, mass loss is mainly occurring if water, Tribag and Co-Tribag, this is both encapsulated and non-encapsulated form, been introduced. There's a mass loss, which is also the same for the bending elasticity. So it's the same data set. We can also see if kappa is introduced, this really slows down the reduction of mass loss. I will keep it also short. The correspondence analysis just shows you the bacterial community structure from fungal and the bacterial community. As more close the symbols are, it's more similar. It's a bacterial community based on presence and relative abundances. And you can see there is no real effect of the treatments, but of the different sites based on the colors here. So just genes means that you have a microbiome from each site which can do the same job, just to keep it short. And then we have picked out some members like Ketospirasia, which can decay wood quite nicely, and also Helvillacella, which are close to North France, which are also quite good in wood decay. So they are present wood decay in fungi, and they increase in relative abundance over time. The same is true also for bacteria. We have some bacteria here which are also known to degrade pollutants and environmental pollutants in organic material, but also to have been used for remediation. They do not really increase, they are just present. Maybe if you go to the Pareto curves, that these are just 80% doing some things and promoting others to doing their job more perfectly than they would do without those guys. Okay, then we did Venn diagrams just to see if there's any relationship between the sites, the incubation times, and the treatments, and you can see that the majority of fungal community is fluctuating. You have some in the beginning which been removed by others in the later stage of incubation. However, if you look for bacteria, they're more or less stable. They do not care about these treatments and the sampling sites and the time points. They are almost everywhere and just being present. Like comparing to the Pareto curves, 80% of them just waiting for the chance, and these taking the chance and making the fluctuation. We use also Shannon diversity indices, which just indicates how the diversity shifts over time based on the relative abundance and their presence. And you can see if you use kappa, you have high differences here, and if you use other things, the shifts in diversity are not so harsh. So, trying to be in time. coming to my conclusions, fungal and bacterial community structure was highly site-specific rather than treatment-specific, what we really thought to be. We have high bacterial gene copy numbers, which I left out these data sets, which are correlated to high mass loss and loss of elasticity of the wooden specimen, and sequence analysis over time reveals an increase in relative abundance of fungal and bacterial wood decaying community members. And this capsulation, you may ask me now, what is this capsulation really doing? And we can say at that stage, we have had used too low amounts to see real differences between capsulated and non-capsulated wood. But now we are already done doing this stuff in field experiments in North Germany, in South France, and in Central Germany, and we used higher concentrations, and there we see a big difference. So meaning, if you make it too good for the microbes, they do not really differentiate between the treatments. But if you do it in the natural conditions, you can see huge differences. Maybe I will show you up in the next conference. The data set is not complete yet. Okay, so let me acknowledge some people which have helped in this work is from this Federal Institute of Materials Testing is Helena Mattis and Udo Schoknecht, Wolfram Pritzko and Ina Stefan, and also Wolf-Rainer Abraham from the Helmholtz Institute in Braunschweig helped us. And this is our whole group in bioanalytics in Coburg, and these two girls helped us at the BAM. And the financial support was done from Wohlmann, which is a company from BASF, and from Obermeier, which are independent. So thank you for your kind audience.
Questions?
Thank you very much, Dr. Noll. We have a coffee break coming up, so any questions now will be at the expense of the coffee break. Meaning,
it's
ask quick questions. We'll allow two.
Thank you very much for your presentation. I'd like to know why, when you add the copper to your samples, why the diversity of bacteria is higher?
The diversity is what?
The bacterial diversity is higher.
Desire.
Yeah, you should.
As higher. Okay, it's higher.
But
okay. This is a reduction of the diversity you have based on the copper, which means that the major players, if you go to the Pareto curves, the major players been reduced and taken over by the 80%, which be not reduced, and therefore diversity shifts. So it's nice that he did the first talk. Did you understand what I mean? You have major players, 20%, and you have 80% which are just dormant or just hanging around. And if the 20% which are doing the main job being not tolerating the copper, then the 80% just increases, and therefore they have a shift in diversity.
Okay, they increase the number and also the index. Okay.
Yeah. You get me wrong, sorry for that. We know that if you have this copper HDO, it's really working perfectly if you use pure cultures and fungi. But if you introduce this copper HDO into soil, it's been degraded. And we just want to know which bugs do the job by degradation. Yeah.
Okay, everybody, coffee break.